Penguin Random House Audio presents Storyteller by Leslie Marmon Silko. Read for you by Tara Gatewood. This book is dedicated to the storytellers as far back as memory goes, and to the telling which continues, and through which they all live and we with them. Introduction. All human languages have words and tones of voice we use when we want to impart information. If you think about it, nearly everything of consequence that we tell one another involves narration or story. When we explain ourselves or our reasoning in a situation, when we describe what we remember of an experience, we organize the experience into a narrative structure to communicate the information. The narrative may begin anywhere, at the conclusion of the incident with the result, then backtracking to the actions that led to the results. Or one may start at the beginning and proceed in a linear manner, step by step, leading to action and finally the conclusion. Often, there are stories about other stories and differing versions of the same events. The human capacity for language and storytelling go hand in hand. Neither precedes the other. Rather, the urge to share our experience, to tell our stories to another human, is so strong that humans invented languages, sign languages, and spoken languages, but also dance, music, and painting in order to communicate the full range of our experiences. Sign languages are highly sophisticated and involve body language, which may reveal far more than the spoken word. Sign languages must have served our ancient ancestors well on the African plains when they were stalking game and any sound would stampede the prey. Sign language also served humans when danger threatened and silence was essential. Help might have been one of the first words in human language, along with run or hide. But once the danger had passed, the urge to tell and the need to know what had happened would have been paramount. This exchange of information through stories about what had just happened was a primary factor in the survival of human species in a world in which nearly all creatures were either bigger, stronger, or faster than human beings. So, I imagine that at first, humans exchanged stories to acquire knowledge as a survival strategy, to learn to anticipate the many threats and dangers in their world. Considerable details and vivid descriptions were essential to the telling. The most important actions in a story might be repeated to make sure the listeners remembered what to do to survive in a similar situation. I like to imagine that the listeners took solace, but also pleasure in hearing these stories told by survivors, amazing stories with happy endings. These stories gave them the heart to face danger with the hope that if they did exactly what the survivor had done, then they too might survive. So they paid close attention to the survivor's story, and thus stories rich in detail and description became the most pleasurable because they gave the listeners the most information. The association of knowledge with power begins here. Storytelling also gave expression to fears and dreams and to faith and belief. Religious ceremonies came out of certain sacred stories that describe the relationship between humans and the spirit world or gods. Storytelling among the family and clan members served as a group rehearsal of survival strategies that had worked for the Pueblo people for thousands of years. This was the case among the Pueblo people of the Southwest and at Laguna Pueblo, where I am from. The entire culture, all the knowledge, experience, and beliefs were kept in the human memory of the Pueblo people in the form of narratives that were told and retold from generation to generation. The people perceive themselves in the world as part of an ancient, continuous story composed of innumerable bundles of other stories. The impulse of the old-time Pueblo people was to leave nothing out. They were not prudish about subject matter because valuable experience and knowledge are found in all levels of human activity. As I wrote in my essay on Story and Landscape, accounts of the appearance of the first Europeans in Pueblo country, or the tragic encounters between Pueblo people and Apache raiders, were no more and no less important than stories about the biggest mule deer ever taken or adulterous couples surprised in cornfields and chicken coops. Whatever happened, the Pueblo people instinctively sorted events and details into a loose narrative structure. Everything became story. Stories most often told are not made up or fictional stories, but narrative accounts of incidents that the teller has experienced or heard about. Storytelling was not a formal event, but rather an exchange of stories, usually village gossip or family affairs. There were no official storytellers. Everyone could tell stories, and everyone felt responsible for remembering stories and retelling them accurately. Humorous incidents are favorite topics of such local gossip and village history because everyone enjoys laughter. For the Pueblo people, a collective truth resides somewhere within the web of differing versions, disputes over minor points, outright contradictions tangled with old feuds, and village rivalries. Thus, the ongoing story or history of the Pueblo people continues endlessly. Location or place plays a central role in Pueblo narratives. Stories are most frequently recalled as people are passing a specific geographical feature or the exact location where a story took place. Often, the turning point in a story depended upon a peculiarity or special quality of a rock or tree found only at that place. Often, it is impossible to determine which came first, the incident or the geographical feature that stirs the imagination. The Humaha stories that I loved to listen to were usually told after a meal with relatives and neighbors. They were for the children, but people of all ages listened. The Humaha stories are traditional Pueblo stories that have been told continuously for thousands of years about a time when amazing things were possible, when the plants and animals and even rocks and stars used to converse with human beings. The Humaha stories describe the various supernatural beings and other worlds and other times that still exist right beside the present world and present time. The storytelling went on in a relaxed manner, and people might get up or move around respectfully. We children listen quietly, but from time to time, an adult in the audience might wait for the person telling the story to pause and then ask a question or contribute another version of the story being told. The audience has particularly enjoyed hearing different versions of the same story because it gave them the opportunity to make wisecracks and jokes about the motives for and the origins of these differing or even conflicting versions. Everyone grew up hearing the old stories, and they loved to listen to stories, but also to tell stories, so that when old storytellers got forgetful, the audience members gently joined in so that the process was self-correcting and inclusive. There are still formal ceremonial recitations of the ancient stories with designated elders who recite them in the Laguna language. One such recitation occurs around winter solstice, when there is a four-day ritual retelling of the stories about the migration and how Kuwait, the beautiful lake place, became our home. I was fortunate to be born in 1948, when a great many of the old folks were still alive and happy to recall stories they'd heard as children, stories that their grandparents had heard when they were children, and so on. In the early 1950s, most of the Laguna people still worked at farming and raising sheep and cattle. Clocks and calendars were not important. The sun, the stars, and the seasons told the people all they needed to know about time. There was always plenty of time, endless time, for answering a child's questions with stories to illustrate what had happened to others. My great-grandmother, Marie Anaya, was born at Pawati Village, north of Laguna. Grandma, Amu, as I called her, used to tell my sisters and me stories about her family and the local history during the Spanish and Mexican governments, and of course, the arrival of the U.S. military forces in New Mexico in 1848 to seize Mexican territory. She told us about her uncle and cousins who were killed on the west side of a tall mesa above the Rio San Jose Gorge near Suwannee. She told us about the Laguna search party that overtook some Navajos with a stolen herd of Laguna sheep. She was proud the Lagunas did not harm the Navajos, but gave them 4 sheep to take with them to feed their hungry families. She told us a great deal of history, but she would not tell us Omaha stories, which were my favorites. She had been converted by Presbyterian missionaries when she was away at the Indian boarding school in Carlisle, Pennsylvania, where the teachers urged the Indian students not to go back to the blanket after they returned home. They were drilled by government teachers to abjure Indian clothes and to avoid all contact with the pagan beliefs of their Indian communities. By the time I was 3 or 4 years old, I'd already heard the Omaha stories from Aunt Alice Marmon Little and Aunt Susie. Those stories were my favorites because the animals talked to humans and magical things happened. I must have asked my great-grandma, Amu, to tell me a story about Coyote because she did not refuse me or fail to acknowledge my request for a story. Instead, she picked up the worn copy of Brownie the Bear to read to my sisters and me. She read us the story many times, and we loved it. She read us the stories of Jonah and the whale and Daniel in the lion's den from a Bible with dramatic doré engravings of the lions and the whale. To her, the Omaha stories, even when told in English, were a dangerous exposure to beliefs and ideas that were strictly...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.